morning and welcome to our worship service today. In just a minute, we're going to hear some greetings from the Bousquet family and also the Parcel family. We also want to thank Bev Peterson for reading in our service today and Mona Tanksley for singing, providing some special music for us. And then as always, we want to thank Brian Bowen for playing our organ for us. Today we're going to sing the songs, O Worship the King, two verses of O Worship the King. We're going to sing all the verses of Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, and we're going to sing all the verses of On Our Way Rejoicing. And as always, you should have received the words and the music to these songs in your email or through Facebook. And God bless as we worship together today.
Good morning and blessings from the Bousquet family.
Good morning. Good morning.
Say welcome to church.
Greetings from the Parcels. We hope you have a great Sunday.
Praying that this video finds everyone well, and praying that everyone is safe and healthy, and we hope we get to see you soon. Enjoy the service.
Chapter beginning at the 15th verse. If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because he is neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. Here ends the lesson.
Timeless theme, earth and heaven.
Eternal.
Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you today and we pray that you will take our passage from John 14 and make it living and real in our hearts, and we will leave here reminded of important truths for our lives. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I don't know if you're like me, but occasionally I like to go back and reread books that I've read in the past or portions of those books, or sometimes go back and reread a story that has inspired me or touched my heart in a particular way. Well, this past week I went back and reread the story of a man named Bill Leslie, and his story has always touched my heart, and I'd like to share a little bit of his story with you today. I'd like to share what a man named Philip Yancey would write about him. Philip Yancey would write these words about Bill Leslie. He would say, I first met Bill Leslie in a grungy pizza parlor after a DePaul University basketball game. I was surprised to find an overweight white man who dressed carelessly, talked too loud, and laughed uproariously at his own jokes. This was the minister of Chicago's renowned LaSalle Street Church. Out of curiosity, I attended LaSalle the following Sunday and ended up staying there. I got to know Bill well, especially after my wife accepted a job directing one of the church's outreach programs. Bill talked too loud in the pulpit too, and laughed at his own oft-repeated jokes, and occasionally slaughtered the English language. But he became our pastor, and we grew to love him. And when he died unexpectedly of a heart attack at the age of 60, Janet and I joined many other Chicagoans in grieving the loss. Philip Yancey would go on to share how Bill Leslie would go to a church in one of the poorest areas of Chicago. In fact, it would be next to Cabrini Greens, which at the time was one of the poorest housing projects in the entire Midwest. And over Bill's time at that church, there'd be riots around the church. Buildings would be intentionally burned down around the church. And because the church doors are always open, and the church was always full of grace, homeless people would come in and they'd be welcome there. Sometimes homeless people would come in right during a Sunday worship service. And maybe they'd sit in a back pew and they'd fall asleep and they'd snore during the service. And they would be welcome. And at least one occasion, a homeless person would come in before the service on a communion Sunday and drink all the grape juice and the little wine cups that had been prepared, thinking that the cups contained wine. And on one occasion, in fact, the only time that Bill Leslie ever considered or reconsidered his call to LaSalle Street Church, one time after a service, after everybody had left, some individuals would come in and they would beat Bill Leslie, Pastor Bill Leslie, with a bowling pin, hog tie him, tie him up, beat him some more, and take the Sunday offerings. And yet he would endure, he would continue, because he loved that church and he loved his people. And eventually that church would become renowned for the incredible ministries that they would begin for their neighborhood and for Chicago, reading programs, they would even build housing units for the poor. And the church would do amazing things. And it would be a church filled with grace, always ready to help, always ready to love, and always ready to share the love of Jesus and his forgiveness and promise of heaven with any who would come and attend their services. Philip Yancey would also write these words about Bill Leslie. He would write this: Bill Leslie recognized his own endless need for grace, preached it almost every Sunday, and offered it to everyone around him in starkly practical ways. Because of his faithfulness, the near north side of Chicago is a very different place today. And so I believe is heaven. Well, the story of Bill Leslie has always touched my heart. and it's freshly touched me this past week. And as I've reread his story, I've had the thought, what would cause Bill Leslie to go into the inner city and minister for almost 30 years? Or maybe I should rephrase that question. Who would cause Bill Leslie to go into the inner city of Chicago and again minister for almost 3 decades? Well, of course, the answer to that would be the Holy Spirit. It would be the Holy Spirit who would prompt this originally young man to go in and share the love of Jesus with people and begin to minister to their needs. When our gospel reading today from John 14, Jesus speaks to the Holy Spirit. He doesn't use the word Holy Spirit, but he speaks to his disciples and he lets them know that he would send someone to be with them after he had ascended into heaven. And this Holy Spirit would minister to them in multiple ways. And in just this short little passage, Jesus would mention at least 4 ways the Holy Spirit would come and minister to them and minister to us. And he would come, first of all, to be with us so we wouldn't be alone. I love the words of Jesus in our passage where Jesus says, I will not leave you as orphans. He would send someone so the disciples wouldn't be alone. And Jesus would say this person would not only be with them, but he would be in them. And I'd like to reread just one verse of what Bev read earlier to accent just what I've mentioned. It's from John 14, verse 17. Jesus would say, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. Jesus would promise that the Holy Spirit would come and dwell in the hearts of lives of the disciples. And we know from Scripture that he would come and dwell in the hearts of lives of every believer in Jesus ever since then. And through his presence, the disciples and we would be assured that we would never be alone. Deep, deep down, I don't believe anybody ever wants to be alone. And Jesus would promise that because of the Holy Spirit, we never would be. A man named Henry Nouwen would minister also to people in poverty in different places in the world. And again, Philip Yancey in another book would share these words about Henry Nouwen. And he'd be quoting or at least sharing some thoughts from Henry Nouwen's book. And he would write these words. Henry Nouwen's slim book with the wonderful title, The Wounded Healer, describes lonely, abandoned people who have no one to love them. Nouwen tells of a young minister who has nothing to offer an old man facing surgery except his own loving concern. No man can stay alive when nobody is waiting for him, writes Nouwen. Everyone who returns from a long and difficult trip is looking for someone waiting for him at the station or the airport. Everyone wants to tell a story and share his moments of pain and exhilaration with someone who stayed home, waiting for him to come back. How wonderful that through the Holy Spirit dwelling in us, we have someone to share our thoughts, our joys, our concerns, our worries with, and have direct communion with God, again, through the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, who Jesus promises every believer would have in his or her life. Well, a second wonderful promise Jesus makes in our passage today about the Holy Spirit is that he would come to be a helper in our lives. He would come to minister to us and help us live the Christian life and help us as we go through this broken and fallen world. In our passage today that Bev would read, our translation would read that Jesus would send an advocate. And the Greek word behind the word advocate is the word paraclete or parakletos. And it's a multidimensional word in Scripture. And in many versions of the Bible, it's translated differently. In some versions, it's translated comforter. It's translated thus in the King James. In the New International Version, it's translated counselor. In our New Revised Standard Version, which we just read, it's translated advocate, and in some versions it's translated helper. I think helper sums it all up. Jesus would send a helper to bring God's comfort in our lives. Jesus would send a helper, the Holy Spirit, to counsel and guide us in life. And Jesus would send a helper to advocate or plead God's cause in our lives. And how wonderful to know that in our passage today, Jesus promises us that we not only would never be alone through the coming of the Holy Spirit, but this Holy Spirit would come and comfort us, counsel us, plead God's cause in our life, and help us in so many different ways. Or almost all we also promised in this passage, also promised, the third thing we can take a look at today, is that this Holy Spirit would be the Spirit of truth. This Holy Spirit would be the one that would come and confirm the truth of what we believe about Jesus, and confirm the truth of what we read in God's Word. A lot of people in our world today are searching for truth. They're wondering what they can believe, what they can build their lives on. And we know that that solid foundation that a person can build their life on is Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit is the one who comes and confirms in our hearts that what we hear about Jesus and read about Jesus is true, and that he's for us. And he can be in our lives as we trust in him as our Savior and Lord. And it's that same Holy Spirit that confirms the truth of God's word as we read it, and it becomes food for our souls and guides us in life. Well, another beautiful truth that Jesus would share today about the Holy Spirit is that he would be the one who would make Jesus living and real in our hearts as we obey him, as we follow him in life. Jesus would share some interesting words. He would share, "If you love me, you will obey my commandments, and I will come to you and manifest myself to you." Can I paraphrase that a little bit? Jesus was saying that through the Holy Spirit, as we follow him, as we make right choices in life, as we seek to honor him by how we live, as we obey him and seek to serve him, the Holy Spirit would make Jesus incredibly real and powerful in our lives. Bill Leslie needed God's grace every day. I need God's grace every day. We all need God's grace every day. But how wonderful to know that as we live in God's grace and love and forgiveness, as we trust in Jesus as our Savior and Lord, as we then seek to honor Jesus and follow him and serve him, he can become very, very, very real in our lives through the Holy Spirit. Well, I hope today you've been blessed as I have been, as we have meditated upon this beautiful passage from John 14, where Jesus promises us that he wouldn't leave us as orphans, that as we trust in him as our Savior and Lord to love us, forgive us, take us to heaven someday, the Holy Spirit would come, not only be with us, but he would be in us. And we'd never be left as orphans. He's also promised us wonderfully that this Holy Spirit can comfort us, counsel us, plead God's cause in our lives, and be an all-around helper in the Christian life. He also promised that this Holy Spirit would guide us into truth, confirm in our hearts the truth of what we hear and read about Jesus, and the truth of what we hear from God's word or reading God's word, and we can know it's for us every day of our lives. And we can know that this Holy Spirit can make Jesus living and real in our hearts as we follow him and honor him in our lives. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you today. We thank you so much for your word. We thank you that we could take a glimpse at this passage from John 14 and be reminded of all that the Holy Spirit can do in our lives. May He minister in our lives always. And may we know we're never alone. May we know that He can comfort us, counsel us, help us, confirm the truth of what we believe, and minister in so many other ways. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Surround them with your healing touch. We also pray for any here at First Lutheran, in this fellowship, in our wider community, maybe sick and hurting. Surround them too with your caring and loving touch. Bring healing to their lives. We pray for our shut-ins. Be with them in a very special way at this time. And minister in the lives of our young people. We also come and we pray for any who have lost loved ones lately. Surround them with your loving and comforting touch. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.